falling from vapors, the estimation power. The next topic we consider is hypothesis testing. My discussion of hypothesis testing is very general, as we will explain how to formulate hypothesis, what are the various steps in the hypothesis testing procedure, how to accept or reject a hypothesis, and all the related issues. And once we formalize the issue of hypothesis testing, we will explain how this procedure is implemented in the case of regression coefficients. Now, let us see how to formulate hypotheses. There are some rules or procedures by which we formulate hypotheses. And remember this, hypothesis testing is always requires, as we have discussed earlier, classical statistical inference class two values. One is estimation, the other one is hypothesis testing. Hypothesis testing is required because, as we have discussed earlier, we have only a sample, and using the sample we have to make an inference about the parameters. If the entire population is known to us, we can directly estimate population parameters. Then there is no need for any hypothesis testing. But this is not possible. And in some cases, the population will be increased. In some cases, it is practically impossible to go for the entire population. Now, let us see how to formulate hypothesis. Hypothesis testing is the process of determining whether or not a given hypothesis is true. Hypothesis testing is the process of determining whether or not a given hypothesis is true. The first step in hypothesis testing is to formalize this given hypothesis by specifying what is known as the null hypothesis. Null hypothesis. So, hypothesis testing is the procedure like this. Procedure for determining whether a given hypothesis is true or not. And the first step in hypothesis testing is to formalize this given hypothesis by specifying what is known as the null hypothesis. Now, what is the null hypothesis? A null hypothesis is an assertion about, a null hypothesis is an assertion about the value of a population parameter. The null hypothesis is an assertion about the value of an population parameter. It is the assertion that we hold as true until we have sufficient statistical evidence to conclude otherwise. The null hypothesis is an assertion about the value of a population parameter. It is an assertion which we hold as true until we have sufficient statistical evidence to conclude otherwise. So, as an example, a null hypothesis may assume that the population parameter mu is equal to 1. The null hypothesis may be that population parameter is equal to 100. Now, this is the assertion which we called as true. Until we have sufficient statistical evidence to conclude that the population parameter is not equal to 100. So, we write the null hypothesis as S0 mu is equal to 100. It is an assertion about the value of a population parameter. It is an assertion which will be called as true until we have sufficient statistical evidence to prove otherwise. Now, this, for example, if you want to test the average height of the population in a given community, how many H0 may be that we equal to 160 centimeters. Now, this is the null hypothesis. And a null hypothesis is always tested against an alternative hypothesis. An alternative hypothesis is the negation of the null hypothesis. An alternative hypothesis is the negation of the null hypothesis. An alternative hypothesis may be that you want mu not equal to 100. It can write it as S1 for the assumption. So S0, mu is equal to 100. Wait first, let's see what the alternative hypothesis mu is not equal to 0. It is the negation of the null hypothesis. And when S0 is selected, we accept S1. Now, this is the null hypothesis. Null hypothesis is the hypothesis which we hold as true until we have sufficient statistical evidence to conclude otherwise, and it is tested against an alternative hypothesis. Now, even though population of H0 and H1 seems to be very simple, determination of what is H0 in a given situation is somewhat complicated. Determination of what is H0 in a given situation is somewhat complicated. And it is important that we must be clear about what is H0, what is null hypothesis. Otherwise, the entire process of hypothesis testing is invalid. So even though it is easy to say that H0 and H1, the researcher must be clear about what is H0 in a particular situation. Otherwise, the hypothesis sin, out of formulate into 0 and into 1. Using the quantitative exam to clarify some points. Now, as an example to this, suppose that a company selling all a company selling cola is selling bottles with 2 liters. Suppose company is selling cola and it is selling bottles with 2 liters. We expect that on an average each bottle will contain 2 liters of cola. In due to some issues, some bottles may contain a little more than 2 liters, some bottles may contain a little less than 2 liters, but on an average we expect that there will be 2 liters. Of cola in each one. Now suppose that a consumer advocate suspects that the company is cheating the consumers by giving less than 2 liters of cola. The consumer advocate suspects that on an average the company is selling less than 2 liters of cola. Now the question is, what is the null hypothesis here and what is the alternative hypothesis here? Now as I told you earlier, null hypothesis is an assertion about a population parameter and it is an assertion which we hold as true until we have sample evidence to conclude that it is not true. So, the company producing and selling cola is a reputable company. So, we expect that the company is doing the business honestly. So, there is no need to believe otherwise. There is no need to think that the company is cheating because it is a reputable company. So, the null hypothesis in our case is H0 mu greater than or equal to mu greater than or equal to 2 liters. This is our null hypothesis. This is the assertion which we hold as true until we have sufficient statistical evidence to conclude otherwise. And it is tested against the alternative mu is less than 2. No. There will be some significance in the consumer advocate suspicion if and only if the company is keeping this. So H1 mu less than H0 mu is greater than or equal to 2. We can also write it as equal to 2. But to exhaust all the possibilities, we write H0 as greater than or equal to 2. Actually, we test it as mu is equal to 2 against mu less than 2. So, as this example shows, H0 is often a claim made by someone. H0 is often a claim made by someone. And H1 is the suspicion someone else has about this claim. Often, in most cases, H0 is a claim made by someone. And the thought is a supplication to somewhat help us about this prayer. Remember this. We will go for a new research if and only if we have some doubt about the status quo. The status quo. If you have no doubt about the status quo, there is no need for a further research. The purpose of research is to find something new, something different. So if you feel that a claim made by the company is not a proof, or if you have doubt about this claim, you conduct a new study, you collect samples, using the samples in testing hypothesis. And if this null hypothesis is rejected, we can conclude that the claim by the company is false. But variations are possible. Suppose that the company is not making any claim. Company is simply selling product with the two liquids, bottles. It is not making any claims. But suppose that we want to demonstrate that what this company is selling less than 2 liters. As an independent researcher, you want to demonstrate that the company is selling less than 2 liters of water. In this case, H1 is what you want to demonstrate. What you want to demonstrate is the alternative hypothesis. H0 is saying, but H1 is what you want to demonstrate is H1. Now you are called to demonstrate that the company is on an average selling less than 2 liters. So remember this. Now what you want to demonstrate is the alternative hypothesis. Now, one way to distinguish between H0 and H1 is, if H0 is accepted, no corrective action is required. No corrective action is required. If H0 is accepted, no corrective action is required. On the other hand, if H1 is rejected, if H0 is rejected, that is, H1 is accepted, corrective action is required. Corrective action is required. This is an easy way to distinguish between H0 and H1. Easy way to distinguish between H0 and H1. If H0 is accepted, no corrective action is required. H1 is accepted, corrective action is required. In this case, if you are a consumer advertiser, or if you are an independent researcher, if H0 is accepted, company on an average is selling 2 liters of cola, no corrective action is required. But suppose that this null hypothesis is rejected using some remnants that we will see later, then on an average, company is selling less than 2 liters. So corrective action is required. Then now let us consider this example once more. Now suppose that consumers are satisfied, or consumer advocate is satisfied. Consumer advocate has no complaints, no suspicion about the company. But the owner believes that the machines, owner advocate, is filling more than 2 liters. More than 2 liters. If the machine on an average is filling more than 2 liters, it is a loss as far as the order is concerned. Now, from the order's perspective, we will be writing a system of us, who is Nastar or who, against the picture that who is greater than who. So in the order's perspective, mu is equal to 2 itself, or less than or equal to 2. But ultimately, the hypothesis is this. Ultimately, the hypothesis is the mu greater than 2. As you can see, corrective action is required. From the order's perspective, if the bottle, if the machine is filling more than 2 liters of cola, what are the odds? So, from the order's perspective, H1 is again so there is a third state involved associated with the company, that is the operator of the machine. Therefore, as far as the operator is concerned, correct working of the machine is very important. So, from the order's, from the operator's perspective, we can write an S0 again as mu is equal to 2. For greater than or less than, mu is equal to 2 now. Tested against S1, mu is not equal to 2. As far as the engineer is concerned, his concern is only whether the machine is working properly or not. He is not siding with the consumer or the owner. So, corrective action is required if mu is not equal to 2. And no corrective action is required as long as mu is equal to 2. So, remember this. The same issue, when considered from different perspective, give us different alternative hypotheses. The first case is from the point of view of the consumer, or the consumer underwear. The second case is from the point of view of the owner. And the third one is the point of view of the engineer in charge of the machine. In all the cases, the principles are true. Remember this. H0 is operating very, very, very common. H1 is the suspicion convert and pass around this way. H1 is what the group want to demonstrate. H0 is accept, H0. If it is accepted, no corrective action is required. H1, if accepted, corrective action is required. So remember this. Principles. Whenever you formulate H0 and H2. There is one more point regarding H0 and H1. The point is, if you are an independent researcher, not a consumer of the or the owner of a company or something, if you are an independent researcher doing research, an academic research, for example, in your field of interest, economics, sociology, psychology, political science, whatever it is, your research hypothesis is always H1. Research hypothesis is always H1. Because what you want to demonstrate is H1. So whenever you formulate your hypothesis, then the result hypothesis is formulated as H1. H1 is also known as the research hypothesis. So H1 is nothing but the result hypothesis. H0 is the status quo. And if H0 is accepted, nothing is discovered from the sample. Nothing new is discovered from the sample. On the other hand, if H0 is rejected, you have statistical evidence against H0, and then you you collected your data, estimates, the parameters, etc., to demonstrate something. So research and hypothesis is the tool. For the tool is known as research hypothesis. Whatever is that field of your study, whether it is economics, any other social or natural sciences, the research hypothesis is always a tool. Remember this. This is true. If you are testing the significance of only one parameter, or if you are testing the difference between two parameters, so between U1 and U2, or if you are testing the difference between many parameters, as in the case of ANOVA, or whatever is the context, the null hypothesis is the research hypothesis. We will say that, as it is known to you, from the language of hypothesis, testing, a test statistic is said to be significant. If and only if it is going to be true. Significant means something has been discovered from the sample. Test statistics is based on the sample. We will say that test statistic is significant. That is, the sample finding is significant. And remember one more point. Whenever you go for research, always formulate the hypothesis first. If you formulate a hypothesis, after observing the results, you can always reject the HCO. You can always formulate the HCO in such a way that it is rejected. So never do such a practice. The correct practice is formulate HCO and H1 first. If you formulate a hypothesis after observing the results, it is what is known as data snooping. The name is data snooping. Data snooping. So formulate the hypothesis first. After formulating the hypothesis, collect the suitable data, primary or secondary, cross section or time series, parallel, parameters, depending on your research question, formulate the H1. Then estimate the parameters, and using the procedures of hypothesis testing, test the significance of the formulation parameters. This is the first step, formulation of null